Hello everyone and welcome to another PC Part Picker live stream. I'm Ryan.
And I'm Barry.
And today we have a special guest, Josh from Fractal Design.
Hello everybody.
We're putting together a high-end gaming rig on the new Threadripper platform. Big thanks to MSI for providing their X399 Gaming Pro Carbon AC motherboard and Fractal for their new Defiant Seed tempered glass case.
You're welcome. I'm happy to be here, and I'm happier more that you guys are able to share this time with me, and I'm probably making your day already.
It's been fantastic.
Oh, it's just wonderful.
Well, Barry, I'm going to get started here.
I'm going to hand this lovely case off.
Oh, you're making me do this all the work already.
I'm just the eye candy, so I got Barry to build this for me.
Let's see here.
You know, the guy brags at QuakeCon about how well he can build a PC. He's like, hey, come down, we'll do a live stream. You can build something. Like, oh, no, you're the boss. Let's see how you do it.
Yeah.
Right. Let's just kind of pull the motherboard out. Let's set it right here, and then I'm going to borrow the strap from you. I'm going to pull it out.
Anything else you need from the box right now, or can I get that out of your way?
I'm getting ready to get the other stuff out of the box. So we'll set it right there.
So you are organized, man.
Yeah. All right, so inside the box, they have a bag of goodies that they sent for us. The only thing that we are gonna need out of here, though, is gonna be the IO shield. And then the other items in here, you've got your SATA cables, you've got your Mystic Light extension for the LED, you've got a nice badge.
Yeah.
And then there's some, then you have some screws for a nice graphics card mount that they have. For if you've got some of the 1080 Ti's, you notice they're not two slot cards, they're three slot cards, and they're very heavy. So this will help prevent some GPU sag.
Nice.
So I'll put all this stuff back in here.
There's a whole bunch of goodies in here.
Yeah. And then also with this board, these covers, this one right here and right here and right here, are replaceable. So they give you a nice replacement set of silver or gold. If you do not fancy the black, if you're more flashy, then you can use this. Yeah. We're just going to stick with the carbon fiber ones and go with that.
Alright. Which I have to say is like a really clean look. I've always liked the carbon series.
You know, yeah.
I think it's like kind of understated, but it still has something going for it.
Yeah, absolutely. It's easy to build when you just have silver and black to match a color scheme, or like a black case with tempered glass.
Yes, exactly. A very minimalistic black case. And we were talking earlier about RGB, and it seems to be like a very polarizing topic, right?
Right.
Like you get people that they hate it. It looks like unicorn puke, which I'm personally offended by. But, you know, I think the big thing is people don't leave it on spectrum all the time. Like,
right.
I think
right.
most people get RGB like so they can get that color blue, like whatever they want to match with their video card or their motherboard. And I think that's the whole thing. It's just vendors showcase, you know, the capabilities of their product by having it run through spectrum.
Right.
So.
Mm-hmm. All right, in this motherboard, we're going to be putting in this thing is our CPU.
Yeah.
So it's in nice packaging. We've already opened it, so we've kind of got it taped, so we can cheat a little bit. But it's the 1920X.
So it's a little bit like a puzzle.
It is like a puzzle. You got to be careful. Don't just lift by the top half, because it comes off.
Right, right.
So once you get it out, I'm going to do that right there.
It's like a Matryoshka doll. It just keeps getting smaller and smaller.
And then you basically just twist it off. I'll hand that to you.
Okay.
And then I'm going to leave this in here for right now, so I'm not just setting it down. And inside here, we also have our torque wrench for the socket. We'll get to it in a second. And then our cooler adapter for our S24 that we're going to be using.
Right. It's the TR4 adapter.
Yeah, TR4 adapter.
Right.
So with this, it's kind of got like this retention clip that can sometimes be difficult.
Unless you Hulk smash it.
Like unless you just Hulk smash it. Then you still have to take this part out. So I don't want to send the processor flying.
I'll catch it.
That'd make it more fun. Just add to your build time.
Yeah.
All right. I'm going to leave it setting in that until we're ready. So before we can put the processor in, we've got, unlike the latch of the other processors or the little pull down and the pins. Mm-hmm. This one we have three screws. So you have screw number 1, 2, and 3, and the socket has a particular order for open and for close. So for open, we're gonna undo 3, 2, and then 1, and we'll just use the wrench that they provided.
And isn't the orders also actually stamped into the socket as well?
Yes.
Right. They printed it in a couple different places to make sure
that you know
it right. So we actually tried it out of order
yeah.
once, and they just don't, they don't screw in right. You can't actually press down, and some of them won't screw in. And
well, so, and to a certain degree, it's kind of like mounting a wheel, right? Like, you don't wrench one all the way down, then go right. to the second one exactly. all the way down. You know, kind of get them started, and then even them in.
And when you do undo the last one, just make sure you hold your hand on it, because yeah. this has quite a bit of retention that will come up and just sling up and just kind of scare you.
We should see how far you could like launch the Ryzen chip across the room just by catapulting it off of that.
I'll pass.
Okay. Yeah. I'm just trying to amp it up.
I'd like to sponsor the CPUs for that.
Yeah. Yeah, you know what? Yeah, I will.
Yeah. So then you have these blue clips that you use that you pull up, and then we've still got a cover over our pins, which we'll leave on until after we get our processor in. But it's got this little slide tray right here to show you how the CPU is supposed to go in. So we'll put it in that way. It's got an orange trail, so we'll go ahead and pull it out now.
So while you're doing this, I have a question. Like, as far as like a mounting solution, what do you think about this compared to like, you know, like pins on the processor, pins in the socket, the slide tray thing? Because I know you can do this on a yacht, I've seen.
Yeah, I like the slide tray thing. It's different. It's a little bit more steps, but as far as taking out any of the fear that you would have with like PLA or the just setting it down in there about bending a pin or something like that, this takes all of that fear away. I mean, it's an extremely heavy processor. But so then we just slot it down in the tray. And as you slot it down, once you get near the end, you'll kind of feel it just kind of click in or clunk in, almost not really a click. So then we'll go ahead and stand up.
This is the hardest part on stream when you can't get to the other side.
We'll just pull this up.
Don't sneeze, man. Don't sneeze.
There you go.
Gotcha.
And then once you have that down, processor's in, we'll just lay this one down.
You want to lower them one at a time.
Yeah, lower them one at a time, not at the same time, or else they won't line up. And you'll hear it click, it'll hold in, then you can lower this one down. And just kind of hold it. I'm going to use a screwdriver right here and just start to twist it in. And this right here, so you can use a screwdriver with a, I think it's a T20 bit.
Mm-hmm.
You just don't want to over tighten it.
I think the purpose... Yeah, it'd be a T20 Torx if you don't have this tool for whatever reason.
Right. But as you're turning it, you'll notice it starts to get tighter. But then this right here, it just clicked, popped back, and you're good to go. So then that was number one. Now we'll go to number two. This is,
it's a little bit what we were talking about earlier, is that sometimes that second screw can be a little bit difficult to get started.
It's also not a ratcheting screwdriver, so you have to take it out every time.
Yeah, I'm spoiled.
Yeah, extremely spoiled.
But going back to what you were talking about, Josh, about the mounting itself, having done both or, you know, three or four different ways now myself too, I was nervous the first time I did it, and setting it down, I'm like, man, if this is not aligned at all, I'm gonna destroy a $500 motherboard or whatever. But having done it a couple times now and having watched Barry do it, it's very easy. I'm much more confident doing it. It's scary. It is scary setting a CPU down on a motherboard full of pins and knowing that, you know, if you slip or you put it in just a little bit off.
Speaking of which, back in the day I did that with an EVGA classified board. I was getting ready to put the processor in, you know, I'm holding it by the edges, and it slips out and like knife dives right over the pin array. And then, you know, the next step is you're on Google like, how to straighten motherboard pins? And they're the ones, like, they didn't come straight up, they kind of did that bend.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's like, oh, if you get a mechanical pencil, I'm like, there's no way I'm going to be able to do that. And then for most companies, I mean, that's basically void your warranties. It's physical damage.
Yeah.
You know, so that's where, a lot of the pressure comes in.
Yeah.
So I think for a lot of people, it's more just, it's intimidating because there's so many steps to it.
Yep.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's what I was kind of worried about. I mean, you go from essentially just open the latch, put it in, close the latch to like a 3 or 4 part process.
Right.
But even with the latch, you know, it gets a little bit unnerving your first couple times because it's like there's a lot of resistance when you're bringing that bar. Like,
and then,
crushing
then the
stuff.
Click, when
the creak, usually from AMD. Oh. Yeah.
All right, so we've looked in the motherboard manual. We're going to use these slots right here. We're going to go ahead and open them up. And if Josh, if you can pass me the RAM and the SSD, if you want to go
all the way over here.
There you are.
And while you're doing that, we had a question about the motherboard asking, on the back of it, there are red USB ports and black USB ports. The black are USB 2.0, and the red are 3.1 Gen 1.
Yes.
And there is also a Type-C port.
Yeah, there's also a Type-C, which I think the Type-C is... Gen 2.
I believe it's Gen 2 as well for the speeds.
So we're going to be putting in Corsair Dominator, Platinum, 2 16-gig kits, so we'll have 32 gigs total for this. So, put it over there.
Don't screw it up. You got this. I believe in you, Barry.
I think this is one of the first times we've actually built with Dom Platts.
Yeah, in a long time.
Yeah,
we can use very long time.
I tweeted out the other day, I found some of the old OCZ Reaper memory that I had, the DDR2 where it has the heat pipe that comes up and it has the fin array. It's like that had to be some of the tallest RAM. I mean, it literally had to be 2.5 inches tall.
Well, that sounds like my RAM.
Yeah, right.
I've got some crazy RAM. Like lightning RAM from a Vexer.
Oh, yeah.
I tried to put it in my personal tiny little case, and it was twice as tall as my CPU cooler, so that did not work.
So for the RAM, you just line up the slot, make sure it's in the right way. You'll push it down, you'll hear a click, and then you're good to go.
Yeah. But this is perfectly a match to the motherboard. I mean, you have the Silver X16 slots, you have the Silver X and the carbon fiber, and you have the silver on the Dom Platt on the top there.
I think it's just kind of interesting, too, like over the years, how much like color coordination or color theme has become a thing. You know, like back in the day, because you know, I've been in the industry since like 2003, it was like, you know, you go out and buy some like cheap tech, we got like a red case, a blue case, whatever. But other than that, there was, I mean, if you happen to have red on your motherboard and red on your graphics card is pure luck. You know, there's no way you can really plan for something like that.
I don't long for the days of transparent acrylic cases filled with UV lighting. And
oh, man.
Yeah, and those skulls. Are like the cathode tubes, too. You know, it's like, what's this glowing mess over here?
Yeah.
Good luck cable routing in that and having it look decent.
But it is interesting. We've kind of seen, it seems like a couple years ago, there was a shift towards a lot more color on motherboards.
Mm-hmm.
And now, as RGB becomes more prevalent, most of them are moving back towards black, silver, white.
Kind of like the motherboard's going to be the canvas, lights are going to be the paint sort of thing, where it's like they're trying to make sure the motherboard's not interfering with the color scheme of whatever lighting setup you want to go with.
Yep.
All right, so the RAM's installed. So now we're going to do our Samsung 960 Evo M2 SSD, M.2 NVMe SSD. So it's 500 gig.
Just rolls right off the tongue.
Yeah.
M.2 RGB NVMe.
Oh man. Stick that right there. Watch you. Throw the box over there. And we're gonna put it in the middle slot right here. It's already at the correct length and everything like that. So I just put my smaller screwdriver head on there.
Yeah, if I can play the old guy card for a bit. I remember CES. Oh yeah. I can't remember what year it was. But like when SSDs were first a thing.
Oh yeah.
And like one guy comes into like the Maximum PC party and he's representing the company, he pulls it out, and it's an SSD, and it's like something like maybe someone on the internet will correct me, but like 6 gigs, something like that. Really tiny. Yeah. $3,000, you know, for that. It's like we're all like, oh my god, you know, that is the future. And then now you look at this and it's like
So this is an M2 shield, which is different. Not every motherboard has one, but it's also got a thermal pad in here, so you'll want to actually peel off this blue piece.
Okay.
We can discard that to the side. And then you just basically just line it up and plug it in. And then push the heat shield back down. You do have to be careful that the heat shield doesn't pop off. It's got a couple little teeth right there.
Mm-hmm.
And push it down and we'll put in our screw.
I love using M.2. It saves you 2 cables. It's so simple. And most of the time, let you ratchet it.
There we go.
Most of the time it's completely hidden on the motherboard too now.
Yeah.
So it's so convenient.
Especially with the shields.
Yeah.
All right. NVMe or otherwise, I like it.
Well, I can tell you, and we can talk about this more when we get to the case, but just the trends we've seen, you know, from market research of like just how many drives people even use anymore. I mean, we got physical hard drives that have like, you know, cavernous capacity, and you've got SSDs that offer, you know, performance on the cheap.
Right.
And then you know you've got the NVMEs where it's like speed and, you know, like a stealth sort of aspects to them.
Less cables.
And now we've got, you know, Intel working with Optane, trying to bring that to kind of the consumer level.
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting. It's very interesting. You don't see cases too often anymore with like 12 3.5 inch bays.
You know, we get requests for that stuff all the time, but if you look at like, you know, the largest common denominator of the market, it's like people aren't looking really for the storage space as much anymore from a pure number of drives standpoint.
Right.
It's like, you know, how big of a drive can I stuff in there? And I kind of feel for the people who have an older system that they're maybe recasing, like they just got like a new motherboard, but they still have like at mine, my office PC, I've got like 4 2-terabyte drives because like it's grown over time. Yeah, I didn't just start over and, you know, I'm just going to go out and pick up an 8 terabyte drive. Yeah. And then now I'm like, I really wish I could.
All right, I'm going to move on to the power supply next. We'll go ahead and get our cables kind of plugged into that mm-hmm. and out of the way, and then we'll bring the...
Would you like me to hand this to you?
Yeah, if you could.
Okay, courtesy of Jacob from EVGA.
Yes. And just like magic, all the cables that we need are right here.
Man. So funny how that works.
Yeah.
Oh, and there was a question about the DIMMs on the motherboard, where they go. We just followed the motherboard manual.
Yeah,
so if you have any questions, just always follow the motherboard manual.
Right. So we're using the EVGA Supernova 850 G3 for this build.
So just take the box.
I'll put it back over here.
So we'll stick this right here, and then. So Threadripper is a little bit different. You normally have your 24 pin, which we have. You have a CPU pin, CPU connector, and then you have our video card, PCIe.
Right.
But Threadripper has dual 8 pins. Yep. Specifically, this one has dual 8 pins. So you actually need to get a power supply that actually has
two EPS connectors.
Yeah, two EPS connectors. So that's something that you want to look out for when you're looking at it, because you may. You may just be putting in a 1080 and it may just have a single 8 pin, so you can think you could use like a 650 watt or a 750 watt or something like that. But you want to check to see how many EPS connectors it has, because most of these motherboards require at least 1.5, if not 2 full ones. So we'll go ahead and plug these in. Start with our motherboard, the right side of the motherboard.
And Kima Scabrin asks, would you personally add some RGB to this build, Josh, or just keep it minimalistic?
See, I get that a lot, right? Like, that since we don't have an RGB case or anything like that, that, you know, we hate RGB. Personally, for me, it really depends. Like, with the mesh, if I see, I definitely would have got the tinted glass. Mm-hmm. So I think it does a really good job of kind of letting the light show through more, you know. I probably would with this, my current Define Mini C, not Define Mini CTG, the acrylic version, I had RGB in that. But again, I kept it like on like a soft white, or I'd pick a color. I didn't ever run chroma.
So. Yeah.
I will say the front of the Meshify C, if you can get your LED strip in the front of it to light up the actual mesh of it, looks really, really killer, especially if you just leave it on the... What'd you call it? Unicorn puke?
Crawly.
Yeah, where it's just...
Yeah, the unicorn vomit.
Yeah, rotating through all the colors. So I went ahead and plugged in our motherboard cable, 24-pin, our dual EPS pins, and then our PCIe. And our PCIe is actually a daisy chain because we will need both of those.
We actually have a question while you got the power supply up here from JustHackin/ asking, what's the difference between an 8-pin plug you would use on your graphics card and one for an EPS connector? And so there's the physical difference, which if you...
They're keyed different, off, right?
Yeah, they're keyed differently, they're pinned out differently, you don't want to mix these up.
Right.
The biggest and most obvious way to see the difference is that the EPS will be 4 pins plus 4 pins,
right?
And GPU is generally 6 plus 2 or a solid 8.
Right. So here's the... There
we go. Or 6 by itself.
This one right here is our PCIe for our graphics card, and then here's one of the CPU cables right here. You can see that it's split, and most of them, I believe, are split.
Yeah. I don't believe I've run across an EPS that would not split into 4 plus 4.
Yeah.
I'm going to stick this down right beside us.
Okay.
And then what can I give you? If you want to hand me the case, I'll do what I can.
Oh, I saw the...
Here's where you drop it.
Yeah. I saw the wrinkle in the plastic on the front there, and I'm like, did we crack the glass all the way down already?
This is why we can't have nice things. Yeah. I can't trust you guys with anything.
I set it down and ruined it.
All right, so we are building with the Define C Fractal Design, Define C TG. Mm-hmm. So I will start taking it apart. I'm going to pull out on the back here. Let me turn it around. For the power supply, you've got a little piece that it connects to. So I'll go ahead and pull that out, stick it to the side. We'll attach that to the power supply in a second.
Yep.
And then we'll take off the back panel. And then, Josh, if there is anything you want to talk about the case.
Oh, sure. I can talk about it. I mean, you can talk about the features as you're using it, but basically, the Define CTG and the Define Mini CTG are what it sounds like. They're tempered glass versions of the Define C and Define Mini C. Obviously, we got a lot of requests from customers and fans that wanted the CTG versions of cases, so that's what bore this out. And then, obviously, the Meshify C is also another tempered glass case that's proved very popular. Internally, they're pretty similar. It's basically, any of our Define series cases are going to be focused on silence. It's got sound deadening foam on the back panel. You know, you have like your vent locks, the Modgy vent up there. You're going to have more of a solid front door where the air intakes come from the side, because that basically kind of like redirects the sound, for lack of a better explanation. And then Meshify C's obviously designed more of like a high airflow, straight front to back, the whole front's mesh sort of setup.
Right. So, taking off both side panels, we have our box here, which I'll go over in a second. We're going to be putting in the S24 in the front. So I'm going to go ahead and remove the front panel, which you have to remove the bottom filter. And that to Urien.
And then get a special set of tools.
And then just pull really easy.
You just broke the case. And what, then, is, what is wrong with you, man?
And then the front also has the sound ending panel also. So we'll kind of set this down just right there for a second. And then I'll open up the box because I need to get some screws out.
So you build a lot of PCs, right?
I've built a couple.
A couple. How quick do you think you can get this one done?
Get this one done from this point?
Yeah.
Oh, you're putting me on the spot.
Yeah, come on. That's your, I heard a lot of big talk in it quick.
25 minutes.
25 minutes. Okay. How about this? If people in chat, do you think I should give away one of these cases? If so, if you can beat 25 minutes.
So if they don't get the case, it's all your fault.
Basically, you know, do you hate children?
I think is the way it's going to come out.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, wow.
I'll throw every social.
You hate free things, apparently.
I hate free things. All right. Let me go through the rest of the case, and then I'll talk to it.
Timer starts now.
Timer starts now. Okay. Right.
You're not on a boat, so this should be easy.
Yeah. They do provide a nice cloth. We appreciate that for cleaning the glass.
That's like getting like the anyways from my wife. Like, back to the
I've noticed you're talking faster already.
Stick these. I'm not having these people blame me for not getting a case.
Come on, man. I believe in you.
So, all right. Here's our motherboard screws right here with, I think, 6 zip ties. Thank you. I love the zip ties.
Yep.
Our power supply screws.
One thing people have asked before, like, why don't we include like 10 or 20? What did you do like on the Define C? I think you used like 2.
Yeah.
One or two zip ties. So. Yeah. It's not being cocky, it's just like, honestly, you don't really need them.
Yeah, at the end of the day, it's down to your component selection. Mm-hmm. And if you chose a ton of things that use a lot of cables, then, you know.
Well, even then, a lot of times you can bunch them up. This has, like, you know, the Velcro straps in the back that kind of cinch down most of them, you know.
And the angled portion of the case gives you just so much extra room to work with.
And I'll be honest, you know, it's like the PSU shroud. It's like, oh, airflow and stuff like that. For me, it's like that's where I stuff all my cables. Like when I made my Define Mini C, it was like I couldn't believe how quick I could just shove crap back there.
And oh,
it looks good.
Oh, it hurts me, pains me.
That's how I build.
Oh, you're the one that has to finish this in 25 minutes. We'll check your cable routing capabilities.
Yeah.
At the end of that.
Yeah.
So I put the power supply bracket on, and I'm just using the screws that are provided in the case. Screwing these down on.
The chat is asking if the time ends at boot or finish building or some other time.
I heard finish building.
Ooh. I don't know, because you could hide that box and then he wouldn't have the AC cable.
Yeah, I could.
So how about finish building when you say it's done?
Okay.
And then if it doesn't post, I don't know, we make the audience go buy a case. See, just punish them even more.
All right, I'm putting the fan right here. I'm facing it down through the bottom. There's a nice
fan filter.
Yeah, fan filter.
Dust filter.
So.
Yeah, basically the filter you pulled out the front runs the full length of the bottom of the case.
Yeah, and just so you'll intake cold air from the bottom and exhaust out the back instead of recycling from what's inside the case.
Exactly. And it was kind of interesting. Like, if you look at like PSU shrouds and stuff like that, for a while, cases kind of went with like, you know, the full open internal layout, and then around like the time of like our Define XL originally, is the like compartment mentality was there, where it's like, you know, we had kind of like the separate case floor wasn't a full shroud, and it's like, and you had a case floor where you had your motherboard compartment, you had your power supply compartment, you had like a drive compartment in the front to kind of keep them thermally isolated, for, you know, lack of a better term. And then it went back to like the open layout thing again, and then obviously PSU shrouds are very popular.
Yeah.
Right, so I'm just basically getting all the cables out. I'm going to go ahead and run the HD audio.
You were like all work now.
Right up here.
You stopped smiling.
By the way, thank you for having somewhere to route the HD audio cable. That is a feature missing in a significant amount of cases, and it is one of my favorites because I don't want to run that cable across my motherboard.
Well, and that's the thing. Like, so obviously, we were not by far the first to come out with the PSU shroud, and more than like do like a Me Too and get it out as quick as possible, we wanted to try and do it right. And there's a lot of things like that that you don't realize till you're building. Like if you look at a spec list or a video or an owner's manual or whatever, you don't think of those things till you're actually in the system and building it. Like, oh crap, now I gotta route this thing all the way through the front and back, and it kind of destroys the look.
And just to say what I'm doing right now, I'm putting in the standoffs because they are not pre-installed.
We have the one key pre-installed, like that one, but yeah, the rest of them are
not.
But
it does come with the standoff tool.
It does come with the standoff tool. I forgot about this with my
talk. Well, another thing with that, because obviously I just like to talk, so if you want me to shut up and chat, just tell me. We originally used a metal one, and then we switched to a plastic, and people asked why we switched to plastic, and it was it's almost kind of like the ratcheting thing, so people wouldn't Hulk smash their standoffs into the motherboard. Because before that, I mean, when you didn't have the tool, everybody's, you know, kind of doing what Barry's doing. You'd hand tighten them.
Right.
It's like, then once you had that tool, people would just wrench and wrench and wrench until it stopped, so... Yeah, it's kind of like at least the plastic.
We've definitely threaded one of those before in a case.
Yeah, and it's like now the plastic cup will basically, it would shred itself before it will do damage. So.
Yeah. There was a question about the case. Are there any plans to change the PCIe brackets and hard drive cages to do similar to a blackout edition like the other cases?
Okay, get ready for my standard answer here. Unfortunately, I cannot comment on products that may or may not be in development at this time. However, I can tell you, like, as far as blackout editions and things like that go, that all comes from, like, customer feedback. The first blackout did, the second blackout did. You know, just the colors that we office on the Focus G, the red, the blue, the gray, those all come from basically your feedback. So if there's something that you want to see, whether it's like a color revision, you know, if you want to see a white version of the Define C or the Meshify or something, best thing you can do is go to our website. On the Contact Us page, there's a product suggestions dropdown. Do that, send that in. That literally goes directly to our product developers, so they will, you know, they get it straight from you guys, and that carries a lot more weight than me saying anything because I have no idea what I'm talking about most of the time. But I mean, that's where a lot of our stuff comes from, is just, at the end of the day, if you look at any business, you want to make a product that people want, that people want to buy, and if you guys are demonstrating what you want, then it's much easier for us to be like, okay, there's obviously an established demand, let's work towards that. So that's a very long answer. The other answer is we have a spare parts shop. If you Google that, it's based out of Germany, so it handles basically Europe and the rest of the world. North America Puget System handles some of that for us, and there you can order stuff like individual PCI brackets, drive trays. So it's like if you want to make your own whiteout build, you can go buy a bunch of like white drive trays, white PCI brackets, vice versa.
And somebody was joking about an RGB version of the case. It comes with white expansion slots. You're free to paint them.
There you go. Exactly. That actually, it's kind of like a DIY bundle. You buy this, and then you buy a couple cans of Krylon or something like that, and then, you know.
There you go.
Mine. Don't forget your IO shield.
Okay, raise your hand if you've ever forgotten to put that in during a build. Raise your hand if you've gotten through the build and you're like,
Or cut yourself and bled, given the sacrifice.
In the day when they were made out of, like, I don't know, razor blades, I think is how they made them. It's like. Yeah.
I'm so thankful, and I think this one has it too. Just it's a padded shield.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, so nice.
Or you always have those like, little prongs kind of sticking off of it, and then it's like those are the sharpest things in existence.
Yeah.
I think they're like recycled scalpels or something.
And I've definitely never done it where the prong was inside an HDMI port.
Oh, never, never, never done that. Never would have come in at an angle and pry it up.
Yeah.
Why won't this USB thing
work? Right. Things don't seem to be lining up.
What is going on?
So I'm just installing the motherboard screws here.
And just to recap, if you get this done in 25 minutes, which did anybody take a timestamp?
It's 2:21.
Okay, so that would be 2:21. That'd be 2:46. 18
minutes, yeah.
So 2:46 Central Time. If he gets it done by then, I'll give away a case. I can give away a Define C. And that's open worldwide, so. Because Barry's covering shipping. You got this, man. You got that Twitch YouTube money.
Yeah.
I saw your McLaren in the parking lot.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah.
It's new, though.
At least you got taste.
My other one's in the shop.
Well, this is just your Tuesday car. Right.
All right, now I would like to thank MSI for making this cutout right here big enough for our ratcheting screwdriver. So I don't have to get a different screwdriver.
Yeah. Well, it's nice. I mean, you have the ability to mount quite a few radiators in this case, right?
Yeah, you can go up to 360 in the front. That just requires you to remove part of the PSU shroud, but that's something we can talk about when Bear's not in the middle of it. Actually, I can show right here. There's like two screws right in the front, one there and one there.
Yep.
And then this little plate on the inside pops out, and that allows basically the full height of the 360.
Right.
You can just relocate your drive cage, which is in there. You can do a 240 on the top. You can do a 120 in the back. I mean, I don't think you'll be running three separate loops, but
yeah,
you can do that. And I think a lot of it too is capacity is often underrated. Like what a 360 can handle is actually pretty impressive, and what a 240 can handle is still more than enough for most people. So
yeah, I know the general recommendation I was looking into it was 120 millimeter rad for every component.
Kind of per block type of thing, yeah.
And even that, from what I've seen, depending on the loop,
it can be overkill. Yeah.
Josh, if you would hand me that lovely cooler setting beside you.
Oh, yes.
Wait, Barry, are you talking about the Fractal Design Celsius S24?
Yes, I am.
There we go.
While we got you talking, because that rarely ever happens.
Yeah, I know. I'm sorry, everybody.
They're asking what's the shroud made from?
Metal. Yeah, so the shroud's made from steel. And the shroud is non-removable, but that's also because it's a structurally integral part of the case. So even when you remove that plate, there's still kind of, I guess, like the horseshoe around it that connects. Because if you look at the rest of the case, it's basically completely open. We don't have any drive cages up front. Mm-hmm. And you have to have, you know, a decent amount of metal. For example, when we had our Arc Mini R2, you could remove the 5 1/4 drive cage and then all the cages on the inside. We didn't do that on our Arc XL because that was a full tower, and you remove that much structural metal and you just got a wobbly box.
Right.
So,
right. So we're gonna pull air through the front. So I'm gonna just set these kind of fans up so I can line them up, and I'm going to go ahead and pre-plug them in. I will. There's a little fan hub up here, helps prevent wires in your case. You don't have to worry about those extra wires that you stuff back behind the motherboard. It's just got a single CPU fan that you plug in, and then it controls these fans, which is excellent.
It's nice not to have additional cables coming off the
like
CPU
off your
block.
Arm, right? Yeah. Like if only they made like a wireless version of
it. Yeah. I still think that's magic.
Yeah.
Seriously, somebody in chat, go find that. Like the wireless anti-static wrist straps, they exist. Barry highly questions them. I think we should have you wear one and then we hit you with a taser. I think that's how static works, right?
No.
You sure?
You're sure? Positive?
It'd be like a Mythbusters episode.
Yeah. Is there a place to, M13B was asking if there's a place to mount a fan underneath the power supply shroud.
Yeah, actually there is. So you just need to remove like your drive cage.
Remove the hard drive cage.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the drive cage in the bottom will support either 2 3.5-inch drives or 2 2.5-inch SSDs or any combination of one of each. And then on the back side of the CPU cutout, that's where you can put 3 standard SSDs. Mm-hmm.
And your SSD trays are made for the higher capacity drives.
Yeah, for the 6 terabyte mounting hole locations.
Right. Yeah, that was actually the first we'd seen of that. So we were double checking and looking into it. And we're like, oh, okay.
And that actually came from our tech support side, where they're getting calls from customers like, hey, these holes are mounting up because, you know, believe it or not, you know, we don't have like every manufacturer in the industry meeting once a month, so it kind of. Not everybody was aware that this whole standard was going to be changed, but mainly on the higher capacity drives.
Right.
So once we found out about that, that was like one of those in production iterations where we made the change and then that rolled out. And if people had issues with it, they could contact our tech support department. Even if they had an older version of the case, we could send them the new trays.
Right. Yeah, I think Western Digital just released 12 terabyte consumer drives.
Oh, man, I wish.
It's crazy. Yeah, you were talking earlier about solid state drives at CES. I remember I was part of Intel Retail Edge at the time.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And I got a 64 gig SSD for $150. And that was like a huge deal.
You need to wear that on your neck, expensive. Like on a chain, you know, so you flaunt to everybody.
And back then, I mean, those were slow, too. I think those were like 200 or 300 megabytes a second.
I still remember like picking hard drives based on like, okay, what RPM is it and how much cache does it have?
Yep.
Remember the Velociraptor?
Yep, I was just about to bring that up.
10,000 RPM drive. It's like I think the first one's like 74 gigabytes or something like that.
Yeah, when I planned my first build, I was like clipping, you know, coupons and things from a Fry's catalog, and I'm like, I gotta have the Velociraptor. Gotta have the extra speed.
Back when Computer Shopper used to be like that thick, you know, it looked like a phone book.
Yeah.
Now I just feel old. I'm gonna go cry in the corner.
And there was a question from the chat asking, the fans are set up to intake or exhaust, and we are intaking fan into the radiator. We bring nice cold air in. and then exhausting out the back.
Yeah, personally, on my rig at home, I have them on the inside, so they're pull. You know, this is like push configuration, they're pull configuration. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, and from the tests that I've seen and everything like that, it's
personal choice.
Yeah, it's personal choice.
Yeah.
Until you go push pull, which generally does improve performance.
And it all kind of depends too, like where you're at on thermal headroom, right? Like
right.
If you had a large enough radiator, you could go past it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like you could use like your home swimming pool as a radiator. People have done stuff like that where you have an inlet and an outlet. If you have enough surface area, it's just gonna bleed off, you know. But
yeah, one of my favorite builds of all time is just like five giant passive tube radiators, and you know, no fans needed in that build. So.
Well, I think that's like a common misconception right now. Is people like, oh, I'm going to go with a radiator so I can have like a silent build, you know, like an AIO or something. Mm-hmm. You still got to have fans to push air over it, you know, in the confined spaces that you have,
because
you're still pushing ambient or room temperature air across, you know, a fin array. So it's like you have to have air movement for that to do anything. Otherwise, you just have a space heater.
Yeah, and the pumps make a little bit of noise too. I mean, they're not silent. So.
Well, and like that's one of the things that we addressed with the S24 is that we added some sound, you know, dampening material to the actual pump lock housing to, you know, limit the amount of noise that comes off the pump. And when you look at case design from like a silent case standpoint, the tricky part is there's a lot of different types of noise that you're trying to isolate. You know, whether it's coil whine or it's a mechanical ticking of a hard drive, or, you know, it's fan noise or it's pump noise, you know.
Right.
A lot of times vibration is your biggest source of noise.
Yeah.
And that's where it's like, you know, you get the rubber grommets, you have the rubber isolators on the drives. I'll stop talking so you can do your thing.
Speaking of pumps, we're going to use thermal paste. It's already pre-applied. I know a lot of people are going to be like, you need more thermal paste. It's a bigger thing. The cores are right here. And more thermal paste around the cold plate's not really going to do too much because the cooler for it is literally in that circle right there. So you do have to remove this. It's the one that comes on it. You just push down and twist. And then Threadripper sends theirs. Mm-hmm. So we're gonna push it down.
So real quick, at this stage right now, Celsius right out of the box supports basically, you know, all Intel sockets and Ryzen. You don't have to like send off for an additional bracket. It came with the Ryzen bracket from the get-go. And as Barry mentioned, Threadripper comes with its own cooling bracket in the box. So that just slots right in.
Figuring out your tubes there.
Yeah, figuring out how to use. There you go.
It's always interesting when you go to put the radiator in, and you're like, all right, the tubes go this way, do they go that way? Am I blocking my graphics code?
Yeah, exactly.
And now on the Threadripper, we saw that the socket was numbered. The brackets for these are also numbered so that you'll do crisscross. I'm just going to screw it in a little bit into each one, and then I'll go back and tighten them.
And there was a question about the case here from Drake KJ. With the radiator mounted in the front, what's the graphics card length limit for the case? And I'll help you out because I was helped out.
Okay.
It's 315 millimeters for your graphics card when you have fans installed, and in this build, the radiator is 31 millimeters thick. So
yeah, plus you have the 20, so you take 31 minus the other 315.
Yeah.
And that's it. We do have all the specs on our website, all of your common specs, basically maximum length of graphics card, you know, with front fans installed. We also have, you know, what PSU length you can have, what CPU height you can have. And obviously when measuring CPU height, it's as Barry has it right now. Figure it laying down, how high it stands off of the motherboard.
Yeah. Yeah, all the specs are listed on your site, and they are also all factored into the compatibility engine on our site. So
I see what you did there.
If you add your graphics card in there, we will let you know if it's compatible or not.
And what I'm doing now is I'm just putting in the CPU fan header. That's all you need. And I'm going to go ahead and do the peel so I don't have to do it later.
Oh, you just broke the peel.
It broke.
Oh, I remember that.
It broke.
Happening before.
I may just do the peel later.
There you go. So you have a protective for now. I mean, because you're under the gun. The
clock is winding down.
You've got 6 minutes.
So I'm going to go ahead and plug in the CPU fans.
Here, come here. Come here. I need to talk. Come on.
We'll stick that up there. Those are done. I don't have a fan up there. I'm going to go plug in my HD audio right here. This nice little hole that I fed it through. Push that back through.
You were rocking on this thing.
Yeah.
Pop the case
up. Time is counting down.
So, front panel. Ron, can you get me the motherboard manual?
The motherboard manual.
Yeah, here comes the next 6 minutes right here.
Well, that would be buried.
Yeah.
Once.
What I'm doing now is I'm just shoving all the cables through. I'm not going to worry too much
So do you have like a particular like method you do like when you're doing cable routing? Like do you like run your 24 pin in first and then?
So my rule with cable routing is I do it after the build is up and running.
So you basically plug in for functionality and then you go back and pretty it up.
Yeah, I kind of have it where I want it. If I need to move anything around, I'll move it around afterwards. But I want it to actually boot first before I get stuff looking pretty, because too many times I've got it looking pretty and it's not, you know, you have a post error and you need to use some RAM or...
That's always great with like an open loop liquid cooled system. You get it all done and it's like drip, like no.
Yep. Yeah, we had that happen to a guy when you were at Quake, Sean. He built his whole system and one of his cards wouldn't post anymore on a full loop. And it was a mess because he had got his cards from like Europe or something. So he's like, well, I can't replace it here.
I have to plug it
and, you know, deal with it. I've got you open to the correct front panel page here.
And I'll segue really quick. So obviously, if you ever have a problem with your Fractal Design product that you get, all you got to do is basically look in the owner's manual packet that comes with it. There'll be like a red stop card and says, hey, if you have a problem, contact us here. Now, like warranty returns work different in different countries. In North America, for example, we'd rather have you call us, especially if it's something like you busted a case foot off. You don't want to have to, you know, tear apart your system, send the case back, that sort of thing. A lot of times single parts like that, our tech support guys can just send right out to you. And we've gotten, you know, really good feedback on how responsive our guys are. So, like I said, anything ever happens, just contact us and we'll see what we can do.
It's right here. This is one.
One's down at the bottom?
Mm-hmm. So that's hard drive LED.
Okay. I think you're going to make it, man. You got like 4.5 minutes.
While I'm doing this, Josh, if you don't mind, I've got a nice graphics card over there.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll start unboxing that guy.
Oh, you want me to unbox it? Great. I just can't be beautiful. I actually have to work here. This is from our good friends at EVGA, didn't
it? Jack said all you really need is the power button, right?
Yeah.
You don't really need the rest of them. You don't even really need that, probably, on the motherboard.
I think he's trying to help you. Okay, dude, this totally came without a graphics card. It's just in the box.
Uh-huh. This is one of EGA's Elite member, Timothy Tiaz.
Yes.
So we were elite enough to be able to get one.
Yeah, some of our other staff members are not so elite.
We won't mention any names.
Yeah. Hmm.
All right. So before we can put in the graphics card.
Can I just keep this?
It's really nice.
Yeah, I would definitely go for that.
So we're going to remove our PCI slot covers.
I'll do what Jay's Two Cents does and just touch the crap out of the gold connectors to trigger people.
Yeah.
Stick these up to the side. If you can hand me that.
Yep.
I think there's an outtake somewhere of a CPU being licked on the bottom before it was installed.
I still want to see if Kyle can actually...
Don't do that.
If Kyle can actually post that system that he built on the yacht. If so, that kind of shows you how durable some components are.
Does he have to post it as built? He can't do anything to it?
Yeah, he can't do anything to it. Yeah. He's like, no overclocking? I'm like, I don't even think there was clocking. It's just that.
So now we have a 6 plus 8. So I'm going to swap these around. Go with my 6. I mean my 8 first.
Oh, man. It's nice when you don't have to do that in one take. Yeah. To make it look clean.
Yeah.
The benefits of the live stream.
Alright. And so now what we would normally do is test it up, make sure it boots. And then we will cable manage that afterwards.
Yeah.
But I think, for the most part...
Well, the front panel's not on it. The filter's not back.
You got 3 minutes.
Yeah.
You got this.
I just want to make sure it actually turns on first.
That's all you get on that one.
That's on.
Cue the smoke machine. I see lights. Oh.
And fans are spinning.
What do we got going?
Oh, you got to... I don't know if you wanted to plug the rest of it.
No, I just want to make sure.
Oh, I just want to power it up.
Yeah. I just want to make sure everything was actually plugged in.
Okay.
I want to hand me the front panel. And
yeah, we can give you the rest of the stuff.
All that good stuff.
That's the bottom. Dust filter.
Yep.
Front panel. Hopefully I gave you the right dust filter.
This is the one for the bottom.
Yep.
That's what I said.
Afterwards. There we go. So... Put this in here, snap it in. There we go.
It's almost like an old Porsche back.
Yeah, you know, we try and call out the race car heritage because this looks like a Porsche.
Yeah.
Snap that on. We'll slide our front filter.
We get a lot of questions about how best to clean the filters. They are washable. I mean, if that's what you want to do. Most people pop it out, compressed air, or vacuum cleaner, you know.
It's heavier than I thought. I forgot.
Yeah, the back panel does.
The back panel's sturdy with all that sound dampening.
I showed how sturdy it was on an XL one time. I shot it with a 12-gauge shotgun. So. You can find that somewhere buried in our YouTube channel.
Yeah. All right. Would you like the glass?
Yeah, go ahead and give me the glass. That way we can...
We'll have a nice peel as well there.
Oh, yeah.
For the friends of the peel.
So, yeah. So we'll go ahead and peel it now. Just quiet in the room. Start right here. Right here? Okay.
There you go.
Get that angle.
As he puts fingerprints all over the back of it.
Don't knock over my monster.
Nicely done.
Like a boss.
It's right here.
You have your screws over there?
They are actually down in my tray.
You know, we joked, but I believe you still have 1 minute left. To have the whole thing.
25, because he says it 21.
Was it 21? We said 25. Oh, well, no.
Well, but it might have been halfway through 21.
Yeah, some odd seconds.
So yeah, we'll give you another 45 seconds. Yeah, you got this.
Another 45 seconds just to do that part.
To screw it in.
Okay.
All right.
All right. So,
let's cables.
Yeah. Let's see if we get the screen.
It's like not only did you do it, you're pretty accurate about the amount of time it took.
Yeah.
I'd say 25 minutes and 13 seconds roughly is when I can have that done.
You probably don't need the internet, do you? You plug it in. Yeah. Why not?
Is it tight?
That's all you get. All right. If you slide the case back towards me a little.
Here.
Creative positioning.
Move this stuff.
Yeah. Just hide me. No worries.
Well, technically, you're still here because unless people have realized yet that I'm not Ryan.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Better.
Let's Greg Fox asks, is the side panel a separate purchase?
Is the side panel separate purchase?
Yeah. No, this is the tempered glass version of the case.
Yeah, so this is the TG version. So if you want this with tempered glass, get the Define C TG for tempered glass. If you want it with acrylic or if you want it with just like a standard metal side panel sound dampening, just go for the Define C. So the TG denotes tempered glass version.
And before anyone else asks, can you get the regular one, the non-tempered glass, and buy a tempered glass panel and put it on?
Currently, no, because the mounting hardware is different. And the next question that we get a lot is, but I want a Define STG or a Define R5 TG or something like that. We are working on backwards compatible tempered glass kits. So while I can't say specifically which ones, I will say it's based on customer demand and customer feedback. So a lot of what you consider to be our popular cases most likely will get that treatment. But if there's one that you want to see, you don't see it yet, same thing. Go to our website, hit up our contact us page and say that's what you want to see.
Okay. All right, so we've got our BIOS up here. We've already got an operating system installed on it, and we've already taken our RAM. It's 3,000 megahertz RAM. We've already bumped it up because with Threadripper and Ryzen, that does help it out.
Right, it's running at 2933 right now.
Yep.
So it's a fairly large performance increase for Threadripper and just Ryzen in general.
Yeah.
To use higher frequency memory.
Look how minimalistic that screen is right there. It matches the case.
I'll say it's pretty quiet. It's not doing anything right now, but it's not like some fans for everything. The motherboard ramps all the fans to 100%.
Right.
Well, and two, depending on like what your overclocking needs are or whatever, with the Celsius liquid cooler unit, there's basically the rotating ring on the pump sets it to either auto or PWM. And PWM is, as you'd imagine, would be run through your motherboard, whatever PWM profiles you have going on. And then auto is more of a temperature based with a thermal node that's inside the pump that would basically measure basically block temp or coolant temp and would adjust accordingly. So,
okay.
It's kind of up to you what level of granularity you want, if you want to set it and forget it, or if you want to go in and tweak it out on PWM.
I think for this one, we left it on auto.
Yeah.
So this is just auto from the factory.
So either way, if you plug it in and you don't remember what you said, you're going to be fine. It's not going to let itself cook or anything like that. It's just how much control you want over it.
Oh, here we go.
Yeah, there's a little bit of input lag.
You gotta telegraph your punches.
Heading out there, yeah.
Right about there. So I'm just gonna.
Oh, I think it just changed on you too.
Did it? It did. All right. I'm just gonna drag it. Drag it right
you
there.
Got it.
There we go. Oh, I just covered up 3D Mark though. Hang on. All right. We're gonna open up 3D Mark. We got a 1080 Ti and a Threadripper, so we'll do the extreme test, I think.
Mm-hmm. So about to warm up in here a little bit.
And while we're doing this, since we're about to make some noise, there's a question from M13B asking, does comparing the tempered glass versus the acrylic version, how does that affect the noise level of the case?
I can tell you, I don't have any like hard and fast numbers just because measuring sound is a very difficult thing to do consistently because there's so many variables that come into play. And actually, if you go to our website, notice I keep doing that. there's called some of the Define R5 Just Silence, where we went to the world's quietest room with Austin Evans and we kind of go through some of the testing process and what goes into it. And there's even situations where, like an acrylic panel, window panel case, like side panel is quieter than the solid because it has to do with like resonance properties and stuff like that. As far as what you're going to notice, you're not really going to notice much difference in sound levels unless somehow you have a vibration. But on the TG side panel, it mounts on rubber mounts to protect it, and that also helps isolate any vibration. So.
Right.
So it should be pretty comparable.
Okay, I can't make that any smaller. All right, so we've got our Firestrike Ultra. We're not going to do the demo just for time's sake.
Right.
We're just going to run it like this, so a cold boot, to see what kind of temperatures we get and what kind of performance we get. Mm-hmm. So, and it looks like there was an update that probably came out yesterday.
And if you don't score above 85,000, then...
It's the case's fault.
No, yeah, exactly, exactly. It's trying to minimize your score.
Right.
So what color scheme do you prefer in a build? Or even kind of flip-flopping around? Or
Most of the time, I always seem to go towards like a dark purple. Mm-hmm. I just like the glow that it gives. It's not too bright. Still lets me see the stuff inside my motherboard, inside my case. But I like it. So that's normally what I go with.
What are you?
I'm the worst. I match my keyboard to the rest of my build. I've got 7 or 8 different sets of keycaps.
Yeah.
Not counting the artisans along the way.
You're one of those guys.
I am one of those guys. Yeah. My current one that's coming right now is a mixture of black, pink, and blue. It's Miami.
Miami or like, Diva or something like that. Yeah,
exactly.
See, like for me, I'll get in there and play with it, and it's like I realize I don't like anything that I do. I'll be good there for dares. I'm like, I don't like that. But currently what I have, my main rig, I don't have any like separate RGB LEDs set up. Mm-hmm. I just have like my 2 1080, my UJ 1080s. I think I have them set to green, but I'll cycle between that and like a dark purple, mm-hmm. kind of like what you do. And then on my Define Mini C build, like I said, I have like a soft white where it just kind of lights up the interior. So
yeah, nice. usually I will run RGB if I'm gonna run it in the full spectrum. I'll run it if the front of the case has something like that I can show off, whether it's little slots or something like that. Mm-hmm. I'll run full RGB on that just for the front of it. But then on the side that I actually have to stare at most of the time, or that's in my peripheral, it'll just be just the normal.
Yeah.
So
after you finish speed building, Barry, give us your thoughts on the case.
I almost messed up and gave you too short of a time, but because I forgot about the standoff.
I know she got a lot more serious once that time frame came out.
I just let y'all talk. So the case, it's like the Meshify. I like it. I think the cable routing is enough. You don't need more. I mean, if you're doing like a ton of hard drives and a ton of SSDs, like if you're filling everything up, I could see where it might get kind of tight. Mm-hmm. We don't do that. I don't think most people do that either. So the little, I guess the inlet that it has mm-hmm. on the side, up the side, it's just like the Define Mini, which we built with several months ago. I used 2 zip ties on it total. We had something similar where we had a graphics card with a single cable, you know, you had your 8-pin and everything like that. It looks nice from the cable management. It's not a glass panel, so you have nice sound dampening, which is, you know, it's all about your taste. Some people want to see the back of their case. I don't know what kind of desk they have. I don't see the back of my case.
Rotate both sides of the case. They have a sit on Lazy Sue's and they spin it around.
So, you know, I tighten my cables up neatly because that's just the OCD in me.
Right.
I haven't done these yet because we'll probably do a cable management video. If not, I can tidy them up anyway, and we can still post it in a completed build.
Mm-hmm.
It's plenty of room. The only thing I don't like, and this is generally with cases, I usually run a 280 rad, but the thing that I hate, that I don't like to do, is lose hard drive space.
Mm-hmm.
However, because I have one 4 terabyte hard drive that I just use for bulk stuff, and it's either like it ends up sitting around at the bottom of the cage because I had to remove my hard drive cage, but y'all kind of fixed that a little bit because you can actually mount the hard drive to the bottom.
Yeah, and then also like the cage itself is you can slide it, can adjust it somewhat. Right. So it kind of depends on what type of setup you have in front with your radiator. So
So that's good because that is one thing that I don't want to lose the space, and then in the back I don't have any space, so it kind of messes with it. But in this, you know, I look at it and I'm like, yeah, I could use that. I could just stick it in the bottom and still be good to go.
Yeah, we did have one more question. Any comments on the noise in the case? And can you hear it? No, I mean I can hear a minor whirring. I mean, I doubt the microphones are picking it up much, if at all.
Yeah, I'm sitting right at the exhaust fan. I don't hear anything. And we didn't mess with any of the fan settings in the BIOS beforehand, so everything's just at stock.
Right.
The pump we left on auto, so it's just that stock that it comes from Fractal.
Well, we get that a lot. Obviously, you know, sound levels, like, people want to know, like, well, how loud is a Define R5, or how loud is this? And the difficult thing to make it really short and sweet is, like, when we tested it, we did ISO level testing, so it can be like, oh, you know, you guys nerfed it, and you measured it from 50 feet away. It's like a hemispherical array, and blah, blah, blah. Short version is, it's really dependent on where you measure it from. And that's where it's really hard to compare, like, readings from one website to another, because there's no standard in the testing.
Right.
And, you know, for the most part, I think we found that, like, out of the box, if you just plug in the fans, and like an R5, for example, I think it's something like, 1.2 decibels, something like that.
Okay.
And it's like, well, how can it be that way with, like, you know, fans rated at 14 decibels? Well, it's all the measured distance where they're measured from.
Right.
And at the end of the day, what it really boils down to is, as long as your system is quieter than the next noisiest thing in the room, you're going to hear that. So your ceiling fan or your HVAC, if that's 22 decibels.
Yeah.
I mean, the vast majority of the time, I'm gaming on headphones. So, you know, if my build's a little bit louder,
it's not
a big deal.
Kind of like the gaming profiles on, like, fan controllers. Like, okay, I'm getting ready to game. Let me boost it into overclock.
It's like,
unless it does that on auto, I think, like, you mess with that for the first 2 weeks, and then you're kind of like, whatever. You just get used to it. So
All right.
Well, let's take a look at the bench results here.
I'll let somebody else tell us there, because I can't quite read them.
Our overall score was 69.88. I can read that.
Yeah, I think our temperature got to 59°C. That's what it looks like. 50. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Overall temperature of the processor got to 59°C, which is quite cool. Again, we used a thermal paste that was already applied.
Right.
We didn't apply, you know, a huge blob or smear it on there or anything like that. And then our graphics card. Let's see here. Graphics. 70. Okay, got the 70, which is we still have headroom.
With no adjusted fan curve, you know, out of the box. I mean, obviously,
speed build in 25 minutes and just power it on. I mean,
yeah.
Well, one thing, you know, if I can interject for a minute, like, when you're talking about the Celsius cooler on, like, Threadripper and stuff, obviously, we got a lot of questions when that first came out. And internally, we had quite a few questions about, you know, things like this big. You know, it's the size of my cell phone, and you're putting a circle like that on there. How's that going to work? But in working, like, with AMD, you know, you find out there's multiple factors. A, like, the heat spreader material, you know, the top metal part of the CPU is thicker. And then, obviously, like, as you said, like, the dies are not out to the full corners.
Right.
So when you, like, if you're looking to buy a liquid cooler or something like that for Threadripper, whether it's us or you choose a different brand, if you go to AMD's website, they do have a list of approved coolers, ones that they have tested, and they validate, like, hey, these work.
Right.
So that's your safest way of making sure. It's like, whatever reservations you have, if they're saying it works, then you have some level of recourse if you get there and your mileage varies. But, I mean, we've had, you know, plenty of okay work with it. And, you know, Kyle, I don't know if he'd be a good example when he built his. But, you know, it's like, it's worked well for us. But, yeah, we had the same questions, you know. Because it's not logical when you look at something this small.
Right.
Something
this big. We thought the same thing, too. And, you know, we obviously verify all the stuff for TR4 compatibility for CPU coolers. So, again, if you have any questions there, you can check AMD, and if you add it to your part list, we'll let you know right away whether or not it's compatible with your system.
Right, and then the only other temperature that I was going to look at was the M.2, which I think is like 38. Yeah. Okay, 39. Yeah, 39. So again, it's got the shield on it. It's got the heat thing, so it's not getting heat. I know some people worry about air not moving directly over it since we have the radiator up front. And we did take one fan out. We could have put it up top. We left the this has the Modi vent, so we left it up there instead of putting the filter in up there just to help
keep it quiet.
Yeah, keep it quiet. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So
then, should we do a giveaway since he?
Yeah, I mean it's your case.
Yeah. So we'll do. We can do a Define C TG giveaway anywhere worldwide. What should we do? Should we ask a question?
Question.
Yeah, I think a question generally works.
If your mods are ready to jump on, or if you want to jump on like the first correct answer, and
we'll have somebody out there grab.
Oh,
one.
Some of the people that work for you will handle. Yeah, it. You're much too busy.
Yes, his people.
Yeah. I'll watch the chat.
I've got people for that.
I'll watch the chat and say, oh, this person won. But
okay, Bear, I'll let you pick the question since you built.
Pick the question. Let's see here.
Preferably one you know the answer to.
Yeah, perfect. I'm going to ask one about the build, so hopefully I talked about it in there. If somebody can tell me, that's going to be too easy because I think it's probably in the title. So we built with a 1920X. Mm-hmm. We've got a 1080 Ti. We've got a 500 gigabyte M.2 SSD, but I can't remember how much RAM we got. So if somebody can remind me of how much RAM we have in the system right now, they get a case.
Well, Barry, you had nice.
Yeah. Let's see
tick-tock,
here.
Tick-tock, tick-tock.
You gotta wait for the chat. You got like 10 seconds.
While we're doing that, while they're freaking out, so whoever the winner is, if they contact, you know, either your site through DM or, you know, our Twitch page, just give us the details and we'll get in contact.
Yeah, we'll get you synced up. I believe it looked like it was League of Lumber there. That is the first person to say 32 gigabytes.
And that's how much RAM
League
we had
of Lumber. Congratulations. League of Lumber.
Congratulations.
Sip.
Enjoy the case.
Let us know. We'll be in contact. We'll get that out to you. Congratulations. Yeah. Congratulations to you for knocking that out in literally like 25 minutes.
Way to go.
I mean, it's mainly because the case is so awesome. I mean,
the case was easy to build with. The motherboard made it, I mean, it's not too hard.
Yeah.
Like I said, the only problem that I would have ran into was with that top VRM with the screwdriver.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, MSI, the screwdriver fit. So it is a PC part picker screwdriver approved then.
Yes. So. Yes, it is.
That is a tongue twister.
Well, if you have anything you'd like to say before we wrap up here, Josh?
Thanks for stopping by. If you have any questions that either didn't get answered in the chat or throughout the stream, you can always hit myself up on Twitter. It's just at FractalJosh or at FractalDesignNA on Twitter. We also have our own Discord, so you can always stop by there if you want to. People showcasing builds and that sort of thing, asking questions, and we're just here to help out.
Yeah. Well, thanks for joining us for another successful live stream, and thanks to Fractal Design for the case and the giveaway, and MSI for providing the motherboard for this build. If you enjoyed our content or learned anything new, please give us a like, subscribe, and follow.